Hello and welcome. This is the Acquia podcast. Today I'm talking with Megan Sanicki. I think most people in the Drupal world will know Megan. She's the executive director of the Drupal Association, and she and I have been talking quite a bit over the last few months, I think, actively since DrupalCon New Orleans, about the Drupal Association, its mission, its role, the Drupal Association board, and the Drupal Association elections that are coming up again for the community seats on the board. I felt in 2016 a little bit confused by the election process, and I thought that there were some challenges around it. And I did a podcast about the election results and how to understand how all of that works with Michael Schmidt in 2016. I'll post a link to that. So with all of that background, I thought it would be a really good idea to just sit down with Megan, virtually this time, unfortunately, sit down and talk about what the board is about, what the nomination process is about, what kind of people might want to consider helping out, contributing to the community in this way. And so pretty much here we are. Megan, good morning. How are you today?
I'm doing pretty good. Thanks for having me on your podcast.
Well, I'm happy. I had a lot of challenges with the podcast over the second half of 2016. There were some real technical issues, and I'm actually thrilled to report that as of late January, the podcast is about to be, now this sounds crazy, but it's about to be findable again on iTunes. There was a problem that lasted a long time where you couldn't find it. I've refreshed and updated the feed. I've renumbered all the episodes. I looked through everything. And this is roughly, Megan, this is roughly the 200th interview I'm doing for the podcast. So I'm not precisely, because I'm not sure exactly how many I've actually done. But yeah, it's great. It's great to be here with you. I'm really, I hope we can help some people avoid some of the confusion that I had myself last year around these elections. So that's why we're here.
Excellent. Well, I appreciate it. I appreciate the opportunity to get the word out. And there's so many great candidates out there. We just want to set them up for success. So it's nice to have this chance to explain what the board does and what a candidate might want to consider before they self-nominate.
I like that perspective of setting people up for success. That seems like a really appropriate way to approach things in the Drupal world. So that's great.
Yeah, it is a good thing.
You know, that or endless discussion threads and arguments about how to... No.
No, we don't need to do that.
Right. I don't know. Maybe you should also touch on the Drupal bike shedding culture at some point.
We can do that. That is one thing we avoid at the board meetings. No bike shedding.
Wait a minute. But this is Drupal. How's
that
possible?
This shiny, special little spot of Drupal where we don't allow bike shedding.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. Okay. I think I need a breath of fresh air. Like, the idea that you could do Drupal without that is incredible.
Yeah. We kind of find that, you know, if you start trying to bike shed strategy, you just get way into the weeds. And it's not really strategy at that point. You're starting talking tactics and doing the staff's work.
Ha. Okay. That's okay. That's a really perfect way to understand that as well.
Yeah, right?
Yes.
Deal?
Boing.
Welcome to the Acquia podcast, Drupal technology, community, and business.
Welcome to the Acquia podcast, Drupal technology, community, and business.
Module for that?
There, of course there is. Like, quick question, quick answers, a few things about what the board is. So why does the Drupal Association have a board?
Okay, well, the Drupal Association is a nonprofit, and therefore it has to have a board. That's just how the structure works. And the board's job is to govern the association. They have a financial responsibility to make sure that we're financially sound. And that we are doing work that's in line with the mission that we've stated, which is to unite the community to build and promote the software.
Okay. And what's the makeup of the board?
Well, we have a nominating committee that's always kind of assessing what we need. And it changes over time because what the needs are for the association or the project change depend on our where we are in our life cycle. And right now, you know, we want good representation of our community. We want people that are strategic, that bring different kinds of skill sets. So, for example, we want to make sure we have people that are in the business community. So we have like Jeff Walpole from Phase Two, who has a good understanding of North American business. But we also want to make sure we're diverse. So we have Vesa Pamu, who ran Wonderkraut, and gave us good insight on European business. And then we've had developers on the board as well. So Angie had been on the board. And, you know, I'll be honest, right now we don't have a developer on the board. I think that's a place where community members can play a role.
So how many people are on the board?
12.
And 10 of those are appointed by this nominating committee. And I believe they have a term limit. Is that 2 years?
It is 3 years.
It's 3 years. Okay. So the nominating committee, with you, you think about your needs, and given that a great part of the board's mission is revolved around financial health and forward planning, the board's going to be looking for people who can read balance sheets and business plans and make sense of them. Then you're going to have people, as you say right now, who really understand the business side, because we do need to put roofs over our heads. Dries is he the chairman of the Drupal Association board?
He is. He is the chairman, and he sits in the founder's seat.
Right, and he's just going to sit there forever, probably until he gets tired of that. Like he's not being kicked out after 3 years.
No, but we have to renew his seat every year. But we keep putting him back in.
All right, Dries, be good. It's hanging by a thread.
Right.
So you have 10 people appointed by this committee that works with you that to this. Now, as of 4 or 5 years ago, the association decided that we needed a couple of positions, the director at large, right? So director at large are community members who can self-nominate themselves to become part of the board, to sit on the board. And there are two of them, and they have overlapping two-year terms. So effectively, we have an election now every year for one of those seats, and that person sits for 2 years while we elect the next one. So there's always some memory, some knowledge transfer, some experiential transfer, and then the older person leaves, and the newer person is then the older person, and so on. How did the board come to the decision that we needed this position? Why is that important?
Yeah. Well, they wanted to make sure that they weren't operating in a silo or in a vacuum. And it was important to have the community decide what voice should be part of the board. You know, the board is made up of community members, but they've been hand selected for different reasons. But they wanted to make sure that the community was connected. And that voting process has really created some great candidates. You know, Addie and Shamila are on the board right now and are providing great perspective on all kinds of fronts. Shamila has given us perspective of India in a way that we haven't had before, so that we're not just always thinking about North America and Europe, right, that we're thinking about the emerging markets.
Shameless plug here. I did a podcast interview with her at DrupalCon New Orleans that's pretty fun to watch and listen to.
Excellent.
Given that the board position is not for a doer, it's really not for your typical Drupal profile, right? A typical Drupal person for me is someone who spots a problem and then pretty much just goes at it. And you know, it's all about fixing it and about getting it done. And the board is not about doing things. Why should one want to be on the board? What are reasons? What are, I don't know, skill sets, attitudes, approaches? What makes an appropriate person for this position?
Yeah. Well, the board's function is to give the strategic direction to the staff, for the staff to figure out how to achieve that goal or the objectives, and they do the work. And so the board is focusing on the financial health of the organization. So how are we going to achieve our mission and be sustainable? And so the board members need to be comfortable reading financial documents And so that's going to be really important. So if you don't like talking numbers and you don't know how to read a P&L, you're going to feel a little fish out of water. So you might really want to think about that. And then we also talk about...
She means a profit and loss statement.
Profit and loss. Yep. Or balance sheet and cash flow. Three important financial documents. And then
this is what we all got into open source software for, I swear.
At the end of the day, someone has to pay the bill. And then we think about what does the project need and how can the association uniquely meet that need, specifically through Drupal.org and DrupalCon. And so the board will talk about that, think about, well, what's the strategic direction? What should be happening in Europe? And how should DrupalCon in Europe evolve to meet the needs there versus in North America? What should we do on Drupal.org to fix a process that's just slowing things down? So there's a lot of strategy conversations, but we have to stop ourselves because we do find like we want a bike shed and we want to get into the solutioning. We have to stop ourselves because that's not what a board does. You're starting to do our job, the staff's job. And it's a very unique situation in the community where you just get to sit around and kind of pontificate and strategize. But at the end of the day, they're trusted advisors for staff. And that's how we use them.
So 2017, beginning of 2017, where is Drupal, the community? Where is the Drupal Association? What are the challenges ahead? What is the board going to be focusing on for the next couple of years?
Right. Well, we're kind of starting to think about the next couple of years. So I can't speak so much to that, but I can give you at least the next year to 2 years. The association did just come out of a hard time, as did most businesses in the Drupal world. We had to make a decision how we're going to spend our money to fix Drupal 8. And it was a hard decision, but it was the right decision to spend down the cash reserves. And we had hoped that revenues would catch up with our spending. We fixed what we needed to fix. The community has Drupal CI and Composer and Semantic Versioning and all these great things, but we just couldn't afford the engineering team and a few other people on staff. So last year we did have to do a correction, and we are sustainable now. We do need some time to get stronger, but we're in a much better place. And so the focus will continue to be how do we stay a sustainable organization as we think about our mission work. And some of that will be, well, again, I always break it down to what do we need on the contribution side? What do we need on the adoption side? Some things that we're focusing on the contribution side is how to modernize our tooling. We have a lot of people going to GitHub.
Yeah.
With the projects. And so things are getting kind of splintered and that's not good. And, but we have a really special workflow that reflects our values. We ask for people to donate time to help with this issue or that. We don't assign a task. So we need to figure out how to modernize our tooling without losing the values that are inherent in what we've created and the workflows that we're used to. So that's one thing that we're looking at. Then the other thing, there's so many other things too. We're looking at different community initiatives. So every quarter we're asking the community what we should work on and pull that in. That's why we're working on the project application process this quarter, fixing that. We'll continue to do some more improvements and evolution of Composer and Drupal CI and the different tooling. And we want to keep rewarding people for their contributions. So we just announced that we're taking the issue credit system and expanding the algorithm. And so it's now called a contribution credit because we want to reward code as well as different talents in the community and treasure. We call it time, talent, and treasure. The treasure is how you're supporting the association to help fund our work. And so now it's going to be looking at code contribution, posting Drupal 8 case studies because we need good content to amplify, and also rewarding people who are supporting partners of the association. Hmm. And we'll keep playing around with that. We want to reward camp organizers, but everything is based on data that we can pull off of Drupal.org. So we have some things to fix so that we can look at all the ways people are contributing and update the algorithm.
So it sounds like a really interesting set of new problems that need to be dealt with, you know.
Yeah.
And from my perspective, with Drupal 8 coming into its fourth iteration now, and the radical, like the number of features and improvements that between 8.0 and 8.2 and what it's going to come into 8.3, it's just amazing. And the whole way that we can have these initiatives that improve the living release with the workflow initiative and all these other things going, it's such an exciting time. And I guess, for you, it's refreshing to be involved in exciting, helpful sort of problems like the one you just described, rather than the frankly endless slog that the middle of the Drupal 8 release cycle felt like. So yeah, that's nice. Let's talk about, so we want a person who accepts and understands that this is about setting policy and setting direction. We want a person who has at least some knowledge, experience, capability of reading financial documentation, because that's a lot of the board's mission. So community health on the one hand, financial, like that's the fundamentals of the Drupal Association mission. Let's talk about, and anyone in the world can self-nominate them for the Drupal Association Director at Large election that is coming this February and March. The association board meets several times a year. And is it still true that if I can't afford to fly to every DrupalCon, if I don't have an employer situation that allows me to show up to go to the board meetings in person, that the association will help me do that?
That is correct. We have the budget, so don't let finances stop you.
Right. As long as you've got the time and the commitment and you want to be part of this, you can be part of it. I think it's a really important message to underscore. And self-nomination for the 2017 election, when does that start?
It starts February 1st to the 19th.
February 1st to the February 19th. Now, how do I nominate myself? I'm going to be putting links with this podcast and publishing links also on social media. What do I have to do to nominate myself for the election?
Well, you're gonna go to the community elections page. You'll click a button to start your candidate profile. And before you even take that step, I should back up. We are asking everyone to watch a video. It basically explains everything I've said here in this podcast, but you have to watch the video because we really want you to understand what we're going to be talking about and some things to consider before you self-nominate. We just want to set you up for success. We ask you to read the bylaws and also the board member agreement so you understand what you'd be committing to. And then once you do that, go ahead and fill out your candidate profile page, and it will prompt you to upload your photo, contact information, and then it will have questions for you to answer. Things like, have you ever been on a board before or a committee? Do you have experience with this kind of work? And given the kinds of topics we'll be discussing over the next 2 years, what perspective would you bring, and what kinds of things are important to you as it relates to those topics? Because we want the voters to really understand how each candidate is going to represent them as we have these discussions.
Is it fair to say that this is about what you can bring to the board rather than you having some agenda that you want to push through?
Yeah, and that's one of the things that I talk about in the presentation is that, basically, like, here are the kinds of things we talk about and the strategic level at which we talk. You'll be engaged in these kinds of conversations on these kinds of topics at this kind of a level. And a lot of it's about financials. So if you can't read a financial document, you're going to struggle. Some people are like, but I really care about that we fix this thing in the community. And like I work with the chairman, I work with Dries and the executive committee to set the agenda. And so you as a fellow board member don't set the agenda, but you can request things, but we probably already know what we need to talk about for the year.
Right. And frankly, by the very nature of the Drupal community and the way we've set things up, if you spot a problem in the community, if it's an infrastructure problem, if it's a form problem, if it's a process problem, there are probably other fora, probably other places where you can actually make a difference. And the board is not about fixing that thing, right? I see one of the great handicaps with Drupal people on our board, and I mean this in a completely positive way, actually, but one of the problems is we're a community of doers. We're a community of people who are like, oh, you see, that's a problem. Now, you know, I can go fix this if it's code, if it's, you know, something that we fix with having a code of conduct, all that stuff. Like, we're really about, okay, I spot it, now I fix it. And, you know, don't necessarily have to ask permission because we're all enabled to get things done. And the board is one of the really odd corners of the Drupal community that it's not about getting things done, right? And I think I've observed that as a disconnect in the past and an interesting sort of personality conflict between your average given Drupalist and what the board is really about.
Yeah, right, that's true, because the staff, that's the doers.
Yeah. So I don't know, I would imagine that a lot of us would feel really frustrated by that in some
time. And they get that way in the meetings when we don't dive into solutions. They're like, we just want to work on the board and like prioritize and come up with this thing and like do that, right? And be like, well, now you're into operationalizing. That's staff work. So
sorry, not allowed to get anything done.
Yeah. And that's why it's important that people understand we keep the board at a strategic level. That's how a board functions.
Megan Sanicki, do you remember the first time you encountered Drupal?
Yeah, when I applied for the job at the Drupal Association.
Huh. So what did you know about it, and what did you go and look up when you saw the job opening? How did that whole all come together?
I knew that. So I had been in tech since right out of college for proprietary software between startups and large companies like HP. Went through the .com stuff. And then I took a break and I worked for the state of New Jersey and helped them market public transportation, came up with a new business model for them to fund it. And ultimately I missed tech, but I fell in love with community work. So I looked for the intersection of both, and that was open source. So I started looking to get a job in open source, and then I also needed a job where I could work remote because my husband and I were moving to Arizona, so I wanted to take work with me. And then I saw the Drupal Association posting on LinkedIn and did a little bit of research. I had been with companies that were associated with open source before, so it wasn't a new concept for me. And then, contacted my old boss who worked with Tim Bertrand at Acquia, sent my resume through. I got to Karen. From Karen, I got to Jacob. And then Jacob and I met in New York. And then 2 weeks later, I was working for Jacob.
What year was this?
2010.
So Jacob Redding was the executive director of the Drupal Association at the time. Mm-hmm. And the board was still in New York. That's right. Huh. So, and what was your job? How did you start?
I started selling sponsorships for DrupalCon.
And was that a full-time job already?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. Because it was pretty much selling DrupalCon sponsorships. And then I basically said, like, let me help with the other things. And we started working on monetizing Drupal.org, like the hosting listings, and picking up a lot of Karen's work and taking it from there and creating the supporting partner program soon after that. And
so this is the beginning of the professionalization of the association, I would say. In 2010 and before, there were an awful lot of things that got done by volunteers, an awful lot of con organizing. I ran the scholarship committee for a couple of Drupal cons, for example. And starting right about then, the Drupal Association went through a big set of transitions, right? Mm-hmm. Can you draw a line, and I'm not sure this is possible, but can you sort of paint a picture of the parallel sort of 2010, Drupal 7 land, Jacob Redding is running the association, which is facilitating a lot of amateurs, I guess, in a way, to do good things, right? Through Holly Ross becomes director, the Drupal 8 release cycle, the incredible effort and investment that the association put in to that, to sort of where we are now, because it's a, I think it's a really, really interesting picture, and it's a very different picture.
Yeah, you know, right. So Jacob, when I started at the end of 2010, no, I started, yeah, the end of 2010. And then it was released, gosh, now I'm thinking I started in 2009, but it was released like January 2010, if I remember correctly. Then we had DrupalCon Chicago, and we definitely had a lot more of like, it was just me and Neil Kent, and Neil Drum was there, but as a contractor, I didn't really know him at the time. And then we hired like Liz Trudeau, and she's still with us. So we were like this small group just kind of forming, but mostly there was still a lot of community work going on. And we were still feeling our way through of like, what is the association doing with this whole community that's been here for so many years, right? And Jacob did a great job establishing our nonprofit status, like all the foundational things. He got us an office in Portland, Oregon, because we knew we needed to get bigger. We needed to have a home, and New York would be too expensive, and San Francisco's too expensive. And Portland had an incubator for us. They were kind of willing nonprofit, open source nonprofits to the city.
That's a detail that I didn't know. Okay.
So that's why we're here, is because there's open source talent and rates were really good compared to other major cities. And we could get into an incubator to get started. So we had a place and we started hiring. That's when we got Chris Klinkhammer. And at the time there was Marta doing our communications. And we were just, when I was hired, it was mostly like, you will just do DrupalCon. Yeah, we might do some stuff on Drupal.org, but that's kind of the communities.
Really? Yeah, okay, because that was all almost entirely volunteers as well, sure.
Yeah. And then by that time, we had been working on two DrupalCons a year. One of our big learnings during that time was, how do you do a third DrupalCon? How do you go into a whole nother region? We tried to go to Sao Paulo, but it didn't work. And that was a big learning for us. And, you know, sometimes learnings upset people, but at least we learned from it. And then that's how we ended up being able to do India, was just, you know, in the future. But we were mostly DrupalCon driven, really, and just trying to get people to know that we exist as an association, that we're here for the community. We had the membership program, always, that Karen created years ago, and we picked that up. And then Holly came. Well, and I should also say, like, when the software was released, there was more focus on the adoption journey, and businesses were really focused on getting the software out. Dree stood on stage at DrupalCon London and said the association should someday be responsible for marketing the project. And I remember because you and I had a whole conversation. We put together a presentation of what we could be doing. But then we were both like, oh, we've got jobs. that's something we can actually do. Right? And so, you know, there was just like this interesting pull always between like helping the developer contributing community and helping the businesses with their adoption journey, being a partner in that. And so it had started.
I think it's a good, it's good to insert parentheses here and say what the Drupal Association is for and what it isn't for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So especially now today, I mean, we do support the contribution journey and the developers in that, and we are working on being better partners in the adoption journey, but we only do it through two channels. We do DrupalCon and Drupal.org.
Right. So you are there to provide the best environment, the best infrastructure inside which and with which the community and members and companies and individuals can choose to and figure out how to make more Drupal, do more business and all that sort of stuff. But the association does not have anything to do with like leads and deals and that aspect of marketing. And it also, I believe, by the bylaws themselves, is not allowed to influence the direction of the code. Right?
Correct. Yeah, we don't touch code.
Yeah.
What we do is In terms of the contribution journey, I break it down into people, process, and technology. Do we have the right people? Do we have enough people? Do we have the right skills? How's that process that everyone's using as it relates to DrupalCon and Drupal.org? And what's the technology that they're using? Do they have the right tools? Is it modern? And so, you know, especially on Drupal.org, I think about that a lot. The application process, the project application process needs some works, right? So in Q1, we're going to work on that. And then technology, we're doing an assessment right now to see how we can modernize tooling because a lot of...
You're talking about all the like getting code on Drupal.org from a sandbox into a full project stuff that's been a bit blocked for the last couple of years. Okay, yes. Good. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. And so we help with those kinds of things, but we think about it just in terms of Drupal.org and DrupalCon.
It's an enablement mission.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then for on the adoption journey side, you know, I talk with a lot of end customers. I've done a lot of user research interviews and just ask, like, how did you adopt Drupal? What are you doing with it? And I always throw in the question, like, did you go to Drupal.org or DrupalCon? Like, well, I went to Drupal.org, but it didn't make any sense to me. It was all like this gobbledygook about community contribution. And they bounced, right? And they just went to whoever showed up in the search. So we could be a better partner to inspire and inform those people and connect them to the marketplace.
Okay. All right, so that's a mission of the Drupal Association. Now, at some point, Jacob left, Holly came in. In Chicago, we opened the development branch for Drupal 8. So there's this huge journey going on. It's this like the most eventful sort of 5 or 6 years in Drupal, right? How describe all that from your perspective.
Right, well, so we all went on this quest of releasing Drupal 8, but boy, there was some real technical debt. There's a couple things going on. I mean, the real focus is around how can we help around tooling? How can we help accelerate and bring the right people together? So the first thing was Drupal.org at the time was being really maintained by the community, but it was such a big project. It wasn't realistic volunteer work. I mean, the technical debt was so big. And so we hired an engineering team that was led by Josh Mitchell. Really great group of people, did a lot of fantastic work cleaning up Drupal.org to make it easier for people to collaborate, providing Drupal CI for testing, Composer. Now we have semantic versioning. I mean, wow, we have 8.3 coming out in April, right?
Oh, yeah.
And that's, you know, so it's exciting to see those things that make an impact still today. But we had to invest, you know, when I started with Jacob in 2010, we had $1 million cash reserve. Because of all the Drupal cons that were being run, it was just all the profits were just sitting in the bank. And we didn't need all of that cash reserve for our business. And the concept was to draw it down and pay off the technical debt. So a lot of the money went towards special contracts and special projects to help fix that, those things that I just mentioned. And so, you know, a lot of Holly's time was really trying to find the right way to get things unblocked from a technical perspective using our engineering team. And also we raised money with the Drupal 8 Accelerate and raised $250,000 that went towards sprints. And so like Angie put out a post, every time that money was spent to fly people together and put them in a room for a week, there's a major acceleration of Drupal 8 blockers being knocked down. Yeah.
Okay. So that's still the association providing a framework within which people can sort of get the Drupal done, right?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Okay. So leaving out years of angst and interesting problems and community stuff, towards the end of 2015, Drupal 8.0 came out, November 19th, 2015. And around the same time, Holly announced that she was moving on. And hey, presto, how did you become executive director of the association?
Well, Drew's just called me up. He's like, you want the job? I think you'd be great.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of it was, you know, I was the first person officially hired by the association, helped build a lot of the programs, and spent the last couple of years really supporting Holly as the COO. And really, so I knew all the operations and, you know, it's just like I had that that experience, and Holly did a great job mentoring, making sure that, like, if she were hit by a bus, I'd step into that position anyhow. Like, that was how it was designed.
Uh-huh. So you really were fully involved, sort of practically trained up and ready to go in any case. So would you say it was a smooth transition?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I already knew the board. I was already going to all the board meetings.
Right.
You know, a lot of the community members. I have a great partner with Tim Lennon, who's my director of engineering. So any gap I have on understanding the build process and our work with that, he's helped me bridge that gap or help me meet the right people. And so if there's any gap in my understanding of how we build the software and how the association supports that,
okay,
Tim's going to step in and help fill the gap, and he's been a great partner.
So you were around for a long time, and everyone I know really likes you and trusts you. And I thought it was a really, I think the community had really grown to love Holly and really respect her. And when when it was announced that she was leaving, you as a replacement, that felt really comfortable. And I think that's important, given the amount of stress that the community has experienced in the last, you know, through the Drupal 8 release cycle, and how it sort of feels like, okay, now we can get down to business. And for me, you were like the right kind of familiar face to take us to the next place. Describe yourself in Drupal, you as a Drupalist, your role, who are you? Where are you?
Who am I, like, in Drupal?
Yeah.
That's a really good question. I mean, I kind of feel like I'm a little bit unique, but I'm probably not, because no one really is that unique. But I'm not.
There are dozens of directors of the Drupal Association floating around, Megan, of course.
Well, yeah, I come from a technology background that was always proprietary. So it was always interesting how I approach looking at Drupal and being like, well, how would a software company do this? And how does that translate to getting a community to do it? And so then also working with government and understanding how to communicate with citizens and how to bring citizens along with a change. So for example, when I was helping to run the marketing department for public transit, if we wanted to do a fare hike, right, that can really impact a lot of people, especially low income. It's just, you know, it's, you have to go out and you have to do public hearings and you have to listen to everyone. You have to hear every complaint and respond to it and just give them the voice and bring them along the journey and just explain why you have to do this. And also, you know, sometimes you can make some considerations, and community members make really good points, that you didn't think about. You go back and you change your plans. And so I kind of take both of those perspectives into my work. I love business strategy a lot. I love being able to hear what businesses out there are trying to do. It's obviously up to them, not the association, to go be the best business possible, but I think it's really interesting to see how the association can be partners and help them, whether it's bringing them to DrupalCon and helping them level up skill, or are they trying to find more talent? Or do they need to think about their own business model? Some people kind of weren't quite sure how to position themselves around Drupal 8, and I've had great conversations about helping people. I also found it really interesting entering the business ecosystem for Drupal and seeing Drupal shops, but I was used to working with system integrators in large agencies that are global. I was kind of wondering when that would happen. And then I think the other thing too was when I came in, I was used to large technology at Hewlett Packard what's called the platform business strategy. So actually it was more of my time at Bluestone Software when the application server was more of a platform. And so my job in business development was always to find third party applications so that CRMs and ERPs and how all these things tie together to go, you know, come together and go to market together to solve a solution. Or to solve a problem, you know, you create solutions. When I came to the community in 2010, everyone's talking about, I do Drupal. And I'm like, you got a platform. There's so much more here.
Yeah, and making Drupal a part of a bigger story and so on. Well, that's great. That's there's so many people in the Drupal community who've become, you know, business people organically because they had a certain skill set or some interests. And in my time at Acquia, I've certainly learned that there's, There's so many ways to skin this metaphorical cat, and some things seem to be more scalable than others, and some things seem to, you know, have a shelf life. That business stuff is, I find that really fascinating too. And I guess that my journey has been somehow, I've had this privilege of like getting excited about the web, and then it's Drupal, the technology, and then actually like being opened out into this other world that speaks to me.
Yeah, and I think what's interesting though about working between government and then coming here is that like before, whether it's because of my sports training, which is very militaristic, it's all about winning, or about business, which is all about winning and hitting your quarterly numbers, right? You can be very rigid and just very focused about like, you know, just do or die. But working in government and working for this community has made me become more, I think, human, more kinder to myself, and more thinking more about relationships. And so it's, I think the one thing I also have learned in the last 6 years is about emotional leadership, self-care, and also care of groups, emotional care of groups. And I am so proud of the association for having the Being Human track at DrupalCon, and also having, now the community has a diversity initiative. These things have become so much more important to me than say like the almighty dollar was 20 years ago for me. That it's more important to me how we move through life together as a community to create amazing software. And so that's become a big priority for me, both at the staff level and how we take care of ourselves and how we take care of our community. So that's just another, just another facet that I bring to the job.
Community elections, I think, is shorthand for the Drupal Association Director at Large, Drupal Association Board Director at Large position. Self-nomination is coming up in February, and the election is in March. And I would encourage anyone who feels the calling to go over to the Drupal Association website and check that out. I'm posting links to all of that. Megan, it sounds like it's a really, really interesting time. Congratulations again on stepping up to the directorship of the association. It's great that you're still around. It's great that you've become a part of Drupal. Thank you for everything that you've done. Is there anything else that we need to touch on today?
No, I think that's great. Just thanks for the opportunity to get the word out. Everyone, you have a great following. Everyone really admires the topics you cover. And so it's a great channel for me. So it's an honor. And thanks for all the kind words.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. Hey, thanks for talking to me. And I guess I'll see you in Baltimore at DrupalCon at the latest.
Absolutely. See you there.